Another week, another six-pack cinema. This week, we break down and review Lady Bird, and then switch it up on y'all and give our top five movies of 2017. Let's go.
Dude, you should review movies.
Oh my god, yes.
Okay, I've had a couple, so movie review.
Hey, how are you guys doing?
Good.
Wonderful. Doing good. It's Monday night.
You guys have a good Super Bowl weekend?
So good.
Yeah.
Such a good game.
No, you didn't have a good weekend. It was a good game, but you didn't have a good weekend because they lost.
That was honestly the best game, Super Bowl game I feel like I've seen in a long time.
Last year was so much better.
You're just saying that because the Pats won.
No, because it was a miraculous comeback. 25 points. But this was a better game throughout. No, this game didn't have defense throughout. Still not bad. Not a bad game. I would say it was probably number two Super Bowl of all time, for sure.
No, this was much better. Yeah, I think this is the best Super Bowl of all time.
I did make money for the first time ever on a game.
Nice. Yeah. Congrats. There you go. So you're...
I won $200 from the final score. So that kind of took the sting off of a little bit.
So you're happy they
Sweet.
Lost. Good
so now you got the gambling bug just in time when you're going
to need
your actual money.
Oh. It was just squares.
That doesn't count.
Nice. I didn't see any of the game. I was on an airplane. Middle seat sucked.
But you're a baseball guy.
They weren't like showing it?
On the airplane? No.
Yeah.
A lot of airplanes don't have TVs anymore.
Anymore?
That's stupid.
Yeah, they used to.
I only fly JetBlue and they always do.
Oh yeah, United and American, Virgin, they just have a little spot for you to put your own device, like your iPad or your phone. And then you can get their Wi-Fi, which has their packages of movies and everything on there.
That's stupid.
That's how the newer planes do it.
I'm irrationally angry now.
Because they save money by not having those screens, and they're charging you more money by having you rent their shitty-ass Wi-Fi.
Yep. Oh, yeah. That's the game. And the Wi-Fi never works.
No.
Yeah.
Because you're in a tin can 30,000 feet in the air. Imagine that.
Yeah. I get scared flying these days. Didn't used to.
I always take a Ziploc baggie of nips because you can bring those on your carry-on.
Oh, nice. Get drunk.
Because I need to be medicated for flights.
I am so comfortable on flights. I can't remember the last time I was still awake when we left the gate. I normally fall asleep as soon as I get in my seat and then wake up either as we're landing or within 30 minutes of when we're going to land.
I could never do that.
It's great.
I white knuckle it whenever we take off, and if I'm not fully aware of what's happening when we're landing, I may shit my pants. Because if that bump hits and I'm not paying attention, good night.
Oof, yeah. I just flew a ton as a kid, so I got super comfortable with it, and now it's soothing to me. But we're not here to talk about flying. We're here to talk about movies. This week, specifically, Lady Bird. So let's give our snap impressions. Jimmy, you were the first one of us to see it, so I'll let you give the first review.
I saw this a long time ago. Funnier than I thought it was going to be. Better than I thought it was going to be. This is I Love Coming of Age, and it's from 2000. It's placed in 2004, which is, you know, I was coming of 2002. Well, whatever, early 2000s, which is when I was like, you know, that age, a little younger. But I loved it. It struck a lot of chords with me. I thought it was really good writing and acting and slice of life, normal stuff. I am a big fan. My favorite movie of the year. I think I can say that squarely now.
Oh, wow. Yep. That's impressive. Sheehan, how do you feel?
Fully in agreement. This movie was just wonderful. I laughed a lot. Cried a little bit. It's just I feel like everyone sitting there in there with a family could relate to at least two, maybe three of the characters in the family, easily.
Yeah.
I checked three of those boxes. It was for sure. Yeah. It had some holes. It had some parts that I looking back on, I was like, well, that was kind of stupid. We'll get into that later. But overall, I have to agree. It was top movie of the year for me.
Wow, nice. I didn't know you were that much in agreement.
Very much so. I walked out of that, called my mom. I was like, hey, you need to see this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I loved it as well. It's up there for me. Everything you guys said, I agree with. And I'm excited. I don't remember who I was talking to. It may have been with you off camera, Jimmy. But someone I was talking to with recently said that they think this is the start of movies that are going to be nostalgic about when we were growing up in like the early 2000s, because all the filmmakers from our generation are finally getting to make the films they want to make. And so that we're going to get a wave of movies based on that time frame, and I'm all here for it. It hit me right in the feels watching this movie a few times.
So I didn't know Saoirse. I didn't know her. Actually, I knew
Saruman.
I seen like previews for Brooklyn before, but she looks so different in this than Brooklyn because they made her look really raw without makeup, which was a good move.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know her. I didn't know any of the actors, really. The mom kind of looked familiar, but I wasn't positive. Anyway, what I'm getting at is I legitimately had a moment where I was like, did they film this in the early 2000s and it just got tabled? The gay boyfriend looked so old, like from that era. And then but he's from Manchester by the Sea. I know that.
Okay, good. So you couldn't have had that thought for too long.
No. It was like a split second where I was just like, okay, damn, this is really authentic to that time period. I thought it was really authentic to it, where I was like, no. I immediately was like, no, that didn't happen, Jimmy. But I'm just saying, it flashed in my brain that I thought it was really authentic to that time period.
At first, when I said it was 2002, I was like, well, that's an odd time to pick. And I was kind of skeptical right off the bat.
Mm-hmm.
But it fit like a glove. I mean, I was in high school in 2002, so I was 2 years younger than her at this time, and I'll tell you, the baggy pants, like the flares, the dyed hair, the shirts, the stripes, everything made sense. The binder full of CDs, the details were spot on, and nostalgia was real in this one.
Oh yeah. Agree. I'm a little bit younger than y'all, so I wasn't in high school yet, but everything, it was still like that when I was in high school, and I knew at least half a dozen people that you could have dropped them into this movie and they would have fit in as characters perfectly.
Oh, and the puka shell necklace on Danny? Woo! Yeah.
Straight. Do you know how they got the screen? They got the effect to look like that?
No.
She took the first prints of the first like sides or whatever, or slides, or I can't think of the term. She took them and she brought them to Walgreens or whatever and Xeroxed them 15 times until it looked kind of grainy and like a memory. And then she brought it to her editor, colorist or whatever, and said, make it look like that. And that's why it looked kind of grainy and old. Like, it looked like a memory.
I think maybe that was part of the... I didn't notice that, but when you say it, yeah, okay, yeah. It makes a lot of sense watching a movie from that period.
Yeah, noticed it, but I had kind of assumed that it's just like an older camera or something. I didn't know that they had to do like Xerox it and bring it to a colorist and like make sure it looks old. I thought they just used older camera.
It was one button filter, really.
That is like the thing. Did you guys see that Jake Johnson movie, like... All for the Money or One for the Money, or he's a gambler. No. But that it was filmed in a Handycam SD and it looked like really grainy and shit. And it was like, my sister was like, why would they do that? There's nicer cameras, but it's like a feel thing. But I thought they did a bad job. This one I thought did a nice job. It was kind of a little subtle, but it was cool.
Yeah.
I love when directors do that. The first time I've ever heard that being done was, well, fun fact for you, Mel Brooks. He's the first one to actually go backwards in time for Young Frankenstein. He demanded that it be shot in black and white. And this was like 2 or 3 years after the boom of color. And everyone was like, why the fuck would you want to go back to black and white? It's like, whoa, it's Transylvania, my man.
And it works for that movie perfectly, too.
Perfectly. Fun facts. Anyways, go ahead.
I thought this movie was a lot funnier than I expected it to be. I laughed out loud. I know there was two jokes or scenes that I was like really laughing, as if it was like the same way I would laugh at Superbad or Pineapple Express. Like, I was laughing. And then there's a lot of other times where I was giggling. The scene where the priest has all the kids in drama, he sits them down and says, okay, let's play a game. First to cry wins. And it's just like the setup there is hilarious. Like putting a bunch of teenagers and saying first to cry. Because then they're all just sitting around awkwardly. You know they're thinking of like grandma dying or their dog dying. And they're all just sitting there thinking about terrible things. And then when he breaks first because he's depressed and he it's like he just felt a cry coming on. And he knew he was about to lose it. So instead of just crying in front of the kids, he was like, let's play a game, guys. Let's play. Everyone real quick, let's play a game. First to cry loses. And then he cries. When he started crying, I lost it. It was hilarious to me.
Yep.
Yeah. I saw this movie twice, actually, and both times my entire theater was, like, dying laughing at that scene.
Oh, in mine, I was, like, the only one that truly, like, found it, like, really funny.
Really? You're supposed to find it funny, right?
I think so. Like,
dark humor.
Yeah, I think so. I think some people found it a little sad, because it is. I mean, he's depressed.
I smiled at that, but I was genuinely like, aw, that sucks.
I felt bad for that guy.
It was genuinely like, oh shit.
That but scene later in the movie when he's with her mom and saying, "Please don't tell Lady Bird about this." I was like, oh, this poor guy. He's like,
yeah.
I didn't realize until the end of that scene that that was her deal. I thought she was like a regular nurse.
Oh no, yeah.
I didn't know she was. Was there any like signs of that before that point?
No, I don't think so.
I can't remember. I don't know.
Well, it was definitely driven home there for sure.
The other funny part that I burst out laughing is when that abortion lady was talking, and she just goes, "Well, maybe if you were aborted, we wouldn't have to sit through this stupid assembly."
Yeah. Yep, that was a winner.
So that was mean. Yeah. Teenagers are so harsh like that, where they'll just cut you straight to your core. Right away. Like my little brother, he's 10 years younger than me. Sometimes you just say things and it's like, dude, like you can't go that mean so quickly.
Yeah.
So cutthroat.
Yeah.
And like the line before that would actually kill me more because she was, it's funny. Things are funny to me when they're actually like proving someone wrong.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, just because it's unsettling doesn't mean it's wrong. You mm-hmm. take a picture of my vagina during a period. I was done at that point. I was like, oh my God, it's so true. And you just schooled this girl right in her face.
But then it's like Jimmy was saying, kids just take it from 0 to 60 immediately. She had proven her point, and then it was just like, if you had been aborted, we wouldn't have this assembly.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah, like she was like she genuinely proved her point and won the argument without being ruthless or mean, and then she just stomped on her throat.
Yeah, she was like, yeah, like you know that saying, like
welcome to the mud.
You give an inch, you take a mile. That was right. That it got a little. The door opened up a little bit. She's like, all right, boom. Here we go.
Yeah. Yeah. All right.
I was hoping you were going to say the coach taking over the play.
That was stupid.
That was the worst part.
Yeah, that was like a bad SNL skit.
That was every teenage high school movie ever in the 90s and 2000s.
Uh-huh. Maybe it was an homage to that.
I legit like just eye rolled so hard when that
That's probably one of the worst.
When they cut back to it, and he was like, "All right, you're gonna come." Then he's like, "The Y line, that's singing. You're quiet." I smirked at that. Absolutely.
Well, yeah,
the whole premise of it was stupid. But yeah.
I chuckled at it like the first time I saw the movie, but the second time I was like, "This is kind of dumb." Mm-hmm. But I will say, I think it paid off a little bit at the end when he's just the most excited when they're watching the play at the very end.
Yeah, I agree. Like
he came back to it. They came back to it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Put a little bow on it.
I did like that moment.
One of my negatives, but it's, I don't know, it wasn't really a negative, but one of the things I walked out thinking of, have you guys watched Sopranos?
Yeah.
All right.
Most of it,
If you binge it, the last like two or three seasons, it's like everyone's depressed. Oh, here's my depression. And it's like really harps on that. Everyone in this movie was fucking depressed. And there was a point where I was like, oh, well, you don't, the friend, when she's sitting on the couch crying, well, sometimes, I don't know why, I'm not sad, I just need to cry. Yeah, she's depressed. Like, the teacher was depressed, her father was depressed, her mother works in the depression clinic. It's like, I get it. You didn't need, it was.
I think that's true. I think everyone's depressed.
Yeah, I think that was fairly accurate. And I thought the movie did a great job showing that even though a lot of people are depressed some of the time, they also have tons of times when they're happy and enjoying life. It was one of my favorite things about the movie.
Yeah, that's, I don't know. I like that because I truly am, I think life sucks. And I think everyone is sad at some points. And if you're not, you're not in touch with like life or your feelings. But you can overcome it 99% of the time.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoy a good cry every now and then.
Absolutely.
That's why, that's you why thinking I go to these movies.
This is bad, John, just shows that you're a sociopath.
Yeah.
I didn't say it was bad. I preface it saying like it's not really a bad thing, but I just noticed it. I felt like put the friend crying alone on the couch pushed it over the edge for me. Like it was like one nod too much.
You don't think the fat, nerdy girl who clearly wouldn't get a date to prom wouldn't cry prom night?
No, I think that's pretty self-explanatory. We knew that would happen. But the line where it says, I don't know, sometimes I cry. People just, yeah. I just cry because I cry.
Yeah.
It was just a little too much.
That, the fat friend, whatever, I'll call her that fat friend. Sure. I liked her. Amy. She's a good character.
She's Jonah Hill's sister.
In real life?
Yeah.
Cool.
Wow.
Well, I liked, not liked, it was like sad, but I liked that they put it in there. When she kind of knew who she was and she won the lead in the play and they had the kiss scene and Lady Bird was kind of upset and she's like, well, this is probably, you know, my only shot at that.
that was good. I laughed at that one out loud.
I laughed and it was also, I liked that they put it in there. She was a little self-aware.
Very self-aware.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of high schoolers aren't like that.
No.
Or maybe they are, but they don't voice it. They just, you know, usually it's the heavy, they're very brazen and in your face because they think that's the better way to go about it.
They'll just lash out at the abortion lady.
By the way, that was a little bullshit. I thought that in the tryouts, Saoirse Ladybird was phenomenal.
Yeah.
She was outgoing. She had a great song. She had a little tempo. She was very personable.
Her dance and, was pretty funny.
It was pretty good. And then her friend comes up there and grabs like the lead role when she was... I'm thinking more about it. Maybe that's the teacher connecting with the other depressed person. Hmm?
Yeah, or knowing maybe. That Lady Bird's just going to be a lot to handle. No coachability there.
Yeah, she came in, already had her own routine, and then this other girl who I think had a better voice, but clearly wasn't as like animated. He's like, this girl like needs a boost of confidence.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like, mm-hmm. Okay. I'm going to give this girl the lead.
Yep. I think this movie did a really good job identifying with like the teen teen movies, there's always coming of age and it's like, I don't know what I want to do in my life. And then it clicks. Or like usually it's actually, they actually know what they want to do. They just have to overcome an obstacle to get there. And then, you know, I want to be an engineer and then they have to overcome all these obstacles. And then the end scene is them going to engineering school. You know what I mean? I like that Lady Bird knew she wanted to do something big, but had no idea what it was or what her skill sets were. Like she had no idea what she was good at. She just knew she wanted to be good at something. And I connect way more with that than having a goal and not being and having obstacles. Like the biggest obstacle for me in high school was what's my goal, even in college. Like what do I want to be?
Yeah, for sure. I love the scene when she was talking to the head nun lady and she's like, oh, I want to be on the Mathletes. And the nun was like, well, you're not good at math. And she's like, that we know of yet.
Yeah, that was really good. It's a good line. Yeah.
That was the most teenager line ever when she said, my father's good at math. Why aren't I good at math?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, well, you have to try. It's,
there's
effort involved.
Can we talk about the mom? Because I hate her. And there's smidges of truth. Like I have two sisters and a mom, and the way they fight and how ruthless they are is true. It can be like crazy at times. Anyone... When the director pitched this, I forgot about this, read an article. When she pitched it, the screen, when she pitched it to men who were married and with daughters or who grew up with sisters, they all said, this is exactly how my wife and my daughter are, or this is exactly how my sister and my mom were. And when she pitched it to men who weren't, or like single men without sisters, they're like, they're so mean. This can't be real. So there is like a touch real, but I thought the mom was too mean for me. Like,
nah,
I really hated her.
That's why I like the line when the nurse, the nun's going over with her, like how well she wrote about Sacramento. And she says like you love it. She says, well, no, I just pay attention. And she's like, well, paying attention is sort of the same thing. That's what the mother was doing. You know, a lot of attention. Doesn't seem, you know, she's like hovering. She's very controlling. She's all up in her business. But she really did care. She just wanted the best.
Yeah, but
her mother was
a
raging
think...
alcoholic. So, like, in her mind, she's doing much, much better.
Yeah. But the scene when they're getting her prom dress and she's like, do you like me? And the mom's like, well, yeah, I love you. And she's like, no, but do you like me? And she couldn't answer that.
Yeah.
That like was, like, the most heartbreaking moment to me. Like,
dude,
I started crying. I was like, that's so mean. Lied to the kid.
Yeah, that's
word
too much.
Word for word. No, word for word, that happened in my house with my sister and my mom.
Yeah,
that's too
mean. I'll never forget that. And I was like, oh, fuck.
That's too mean. What? Like, as like actual parenting, my mom just... instilled like confidence in us. She said she grew up really unconfident, so she would just tell us, like, someone, like, if, you know, we didn't get invited to someone's birthday party, she'd be like, fuck them, why would they not want to hang out with you, you know? That's just like pumped confidence, but not in a corny or an at, like, you kind of knew she was doing it, but then it still resonated. And this mom to straight up be like, I can't answer if I like you or not, like, come on. I also hated, I think it shows how tough being a parent is, but Lady Bird gets her first kiss and she's screaming down the street. She's so happy. And then her mom ruins her night because what? She didn't like put towels away or something? Or she came home a little late?
She like
didn't
fold the skirt right.
She didn't fold. Yeah. And it's like you just ruin it. If the mom could step back and like watch that on replay 10 years later and realize that her daughter was having one of the best nights of her young life and she ruined it over folding laundry, she would kick herself. Yep. It was a hard thing to...
No, she didn't know, and she proved later on that there was a lot of things she wished she had done differently, and she wished... She wasn't a very good communicator at all.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, she cared, but then, you know, like, obviously, your husband's out of work, and you're all worried about appearances. It was basically... She couldn't yell at her husband... Because she's a nurse in the depression clinic looking at a depressed guy without a job. So she took it out on the daughter instead.
Yeah. And there was times where she was good, too. Like, she lets her, I'm guessing the adopted son's girlfriend or wife, whatever,
had to be.
Live with them.
I thought it was, like, from a first marriage or something.
Mm.
Or, like, a high school. Like, she had him when she was in high school or something.
I kind of like the fact that they never even touched upon that.
Yeah. Well,
yeah.
Like, obviously, she was very nice to let her live there. And then also, when Lady Bird comes home and they're drunk or high in the kitchen looking for food, and she doesn't yell at them, she kind of just lets them be young and dumb in the kitchen. That was nice.
Yep.
But she still got the dig in, being like, "We wish you were here for Thanksgiving," and then walked
away.
Well,
I mean,
I think that's like half nice, half warm.
I know.
But
I mean, Jesus Christ, she just walked into him drunk and high, and that's the worst he's going to say? I think they had a pretty good.
Yeah, I was ready for her to be a bitch to everyone.
Mm-hmm.
My mother would have beat me senseless if that was the situation, so yeah.
Yeah.
Very nice. And you know what the sad part is? The Lady Bird, she'll grow up for the next couple of years thinking she got away with something and not realize how much of a pass and how nice her mother was.
Yeah.
You know?
Also, when her mom and their dad and they all kind of like, had it out in the living room, and the mom was like, how do you think we feel when you say other side of the tracks, and how do you think your dad feels when you make him drop you off far away from school so people don't see your car? That shit, Lady Bird was being super bitch, and the mom was, she should have said that earlier, because that is fucked.
That's ruthless shit. Yep.
Yeah, that was mean. So everyone had their flaws. I thought the mom was a little too mean at times. I thought Lady Bird was... She never really lashed out. She just wanted love. Really bad.
Yeah. Yes.
But like, she was... There was some things, like you were saying, when she would make the dad stop and get out. But I sympathize with that so much because kids are stupid. They don't realize how much that would hurt their, like, dad's feelings. And she's like, oh, I just like to walk. That's fine.
100%. But I think you have to tell the kid. Like, it was like the way the mom did, like, yelled at her for it and made her realize. Because Lady Bird, once she realized that she was hurting her dad... By doing that, mm-hmm. she felt super bad. She didn't even realize that she was hurting him.
Yeah. I mean, she was okay with, like, yelling at her mom and hurting her mom. But her dad was, like, her rock and her good guy. When she found out that she was hurting him, seriously,
mm-hmm.
that's a dagger to anyone.
Yeah, I think she was I think she was unaware that he realized what was happening and that it hurt him.
Yeah.
So it was good that the mom put it out there.
Yeah, you need that kind of parent out there.
All right, absolutely.
What did you think about the stereotypes or whatever, the tropes, like the gay kid, the artistic kind of douchebag kid, the slutty, mm-hmm. hot, dumb cheerleader, fat best friend. Like they had all, they were all
been very cliche, but they handled them all very well. I felt,
I agree.
See, that's the thing. Like I was
kind of out on the gay kid at first. And then when he corners her at the cafe and like breaks down crying,
well, beautiful scene.
I was like, all right, they're actually treating this with respect and not just like, oh, hey, it's funny, the token gay kid in theater.
That scene was one of my favorites in the whole movie, and it also it reminded me a lot of Three Billboards when they both have their guards up, and then Frances McDormand gets the blood full of face because he coughed at her, and they all like went completely nurturing, and it was like, all right, well, this is real.
Mm-hmm.
When he started breaking down crying, she was like, oh shit, all right, and she became the real Christina, not Lady Bird anymore. She was like, you know.
Yeah, she just hugged him and was like, don't worry, I'm never going to tell people. And
yeah, her teenager douchebag self got dropped and she was a real person.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But no, I felt like the other stereotypes, the stereotypes, but they felt they like were, also fully actualized characters.
Yeah, so, I don't. I think it's easy to say there was stereotypes and tropes and stuff, but go to any high school, they're there. It's not like it's fake or they're forcing it. Like, they exist in every single school.
It's a reason those are common tropes.
It's like there's a sign-up sheet in middle school and they figure out, all right, who's going to be the goth kid? All right, that's going to be me. And
yeah. But they did a really good job not just making them those tropes, making them fleshed out characters. Maybe not the douchebag boyfriend, but whatever.
Oh, he was just hyper douchebag.
It was so funny though. I'm really trying to not be a part of the economy.
Yeah. I said fuck you under my breath so many times to that kid.
The fact that she kept laughing, thinking he was joking, he was like, "No, I'm serious. They're planting trackers in our heads."
I loved when he was like, "Come, I can't think of the name right now." He was like, "We're gonna go hang out here."
The Deuce.
The deuce. Oh. And then she's like, oh, yeah, we're going to the Deuce. And then they pull up and it's an empty parking lot. She's like, this is the Deuce. That's so high school. I mean, that our parking lot, it was called the Bowl. And then there was another town I lived in. It was Wendy's parking lot where like there was a little nickname for that. And you just hang out in parking lots.
Oh, yeah. We had one parking lot. in a corner of a mall parking lot. Everyone would go and just sit in like the parking lot there.
Yeah, but that was a good parking lot. It had a tree, a little piece of grass. It was a perfect parking lot.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Now,
why it was so good.
When you guys were in high school, did you have people like the hot chick who didn't want to leave town? That was just like, no, I want to live here my whole life. Why would you want to leave?
Yes.
Yes. She actually got in my real life, that hot chick, got married like a month after graduating high school and still lives there.
See, I never had that many people. Sorry, Shane. But until I moved to California. In California, everyone I met, like not everyone, obviously. People like everyone. What? Like majority are like, why would you want to leave California? You got snow up there. You got surf there. Why would you want to leave? And it was the first time the majority of people said that, because in New Jersey, Connecticut, Illinois, everyone was like, can't wait to get out of here and go see the world. And then I moved to California and they were like, no, why would I want to leave?
Yeah.
The world comes here.
Yeah.
Yeah. I graduated with 420 people. So there was a bunch of people in my class. And there are probably like six or seven girls, like the hot girls, the cheerleaders who now have 3-4 kids maybe. And they're all hairdressers and they're all very Pride and Peabody, you know, tanners for life guys. And they're all, they go tanning and they have the dyed black hair. And, they're all shitheads, and they'll die in Peabody.
Nice. I mean, good for them. Yep, do what you like, but it's weird.
They're not happy. They're not happy people.
I want to talk about the end, but I don't know if you guys have anything else before we get there.
No. I'm good.
I wanted to bring up, there was some subtle, like, not-so-subtle symbolism stuff here and there. What I liked, after she... I loved the first half of the movie. They had the pink cast. And then after she found out that her boyfriend was gay, immediately after, I guess, it gets cut off. And so her visual appearance from her happy times to the jaded teenager who was lied to. Her image changed entirely.
Immediately threw on a flannel and worked in a cafe.
Exactly. Lose the pink happy cast, and now she's upset and dating the Moody's bassist for the shitty local band.
Yeah, the filmmaking. Did you notice that when there? I thought the filmmaking of like Sacramento was really done with love, and the filmmaker's from Sacramento, so that makes sense. But like with the scenery, and when she was walking in front of the houses they wanted to live in, they were walking right to left, which is backwards in American brains, right? Mm-hmm. And when she got to New York City, she was doing the same exact thing, walking around New York City, looking at all the houses taking in, but now it was left to right because she was finally moving forward in her life. Oh, that was pretty cool.
How about that?
Oh,
that was nice.
Other than that, I didn't like the direction it took that much when she got to New York. I wanted her to be like, yes, I'm here. I'm Lady Bird, and go just be herself and discover. And she kind of clammed up.
But I think that's also more realistic of people.
It is.
They want all this like grand leaving home. They're going to go conquer the world. They're going to go move to New York. And then you get there and it's overwhelming and you kind of just regress a little bit.
Yeah.
And it was a very humbling moment for her. As soon as she left, she got the letters. Leaving Sacramento was a big deal because her mother fucking hated her.
Oh, dude, her mom not saying goodbye to her at the airport. Fuck that. Wrong. She made me
both strong. Times I saw the movie, I cried and I was like, this fucking bitch.
So mean. Like, and then to not send the letters. Oh, that's what I really hated. Lady Bird had to call her.
Yep.
Like I was waiting for the mom to finally call her and like do it. And at the end, Lady Bird still had to call home and be like, I'm sorry, I miss you. And I hated that. I really wish that Lady Bird stuck it out and made her mom be the one to apologize. But Lady Bird's better person than her mother. So what are you gonna do?
It kind of gives you like the hint that like her mom's mom was a raging alcoholic. Her mom was very strict and harsh and bad at communication. So you hope like when Lady Bird has kids, she's going to be even better and kind of like keep progressing down the line.
Mm-hmm.
Because she was willing to be the bigger person.
Do you guys
person.
Ever have the silent treatment done to you like that?
Mm-hmm. From parents?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not
the silent treatment, I've ever, like, it would happen monthly for me when I was growing up. At first when it happens, you're like, all right, yeah, fine. I'm mad at you too. Up yours. I'll take this. You don't talk to me. That's cool. And then by like day 2.5, 3, that scene of her screaming at her face, talk to me! Talk to me! In front of the sink. That was what everyone thinks. Everyone's like, just give me attention. I'm sorry. I'll do anything. Like that. It reminded me of like people admitting to double murders that they had nothing to do with. It's like just grinding.
False confession.
Yeah.
No,
I'm
that
sorry, I'll never leave. I'll never do it again. She, you know, she's lying, but she'll say anything.
Yeah, I was. I'm always like a apology within 2 seconds. Make like do whatever. Make them try to make them laugh. Like if my mom was mad at me, I would be upstairs in like 3 seconds, like sorry. You cannot hold a grudge against me, friend, family.
I will not let you.
Like I will break you in 2 seconds because that sucks. Having grudges is the dumbest, most pointless thing in the world.
If we're
not going to be mad at each other in 2 days, then we're going to cut the bullshit out right now and be fine.
Yeah, fair. I don't have it in me to give a silent treatment because when I'm upset, I like blow up.
Yeah.
And like I yell, I scream, but it lasts maybe 30 seconds to a minute, and then I'm completely good.
Get it out of your system.
We work it out.
As soon as it's out, like sometimes I'll be angry and like I'll hold it in for like a day, and then I blow, and I'm like 5 minutes
a
later,
day.
I'm like, all right.
I would die with a day. Right. Could never hold it in that much.
All right. Is there anything else?
Anything else you wanted to add? Or was that just it with the end you wanted her mom to call?
I wanted her mom to call. I wanted her to kind of like New York and be like spread her wings. It makes sense that she kind of climbs up. She kind of like not. She's a little because she's out of her element. But
I got a little mad. She turned her back on Sacramento when she first.
San Francisco.
When the guy was like, the guy was like, "Where are you from?" She's like, "Sacramento." He couldn't hear us. She was like, "No, San Francisco." I was like, "Oh,
well,
come on! You just
trendy up there.
Went through this."
I think.
Profound
I don't know
thing.
If that's. I don't know if there's a grander meaning to that or if that's just like an oma or to people from the area, because You ask me where I'm from, I just say San Francisco, and I live an hour and a half away.
I always say I'm from Miami, and I'm from like an hour north of Miami.
I'm from Boston, but I'm really from Peabody.
I think it's the same thing.
Okay.
I don't think it wasn't turning back. It's just like generalizing, you know?
Yeah.
Sacramento is a big enough place where people know Sacramento. They have their own NBA team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They don't know where it is. Do you know where it is in California?
Not a clue.
Yeah.
I think it's by San Francisco, right?
A little more north, more east.
All I know is San Francisco, then San Jose and Oakland, that little trifecta, and then L.A. is way the fuck down there, and after that, I'm lost.
Yeah, well, you'll learn
it someday. It's pretty good, though, for actually been there twice, but, you know.
Okay, and now we're talking geography.
Yeah.
Let's hop into our official reviews, critic scores. What are we giving it? Sheehan, what are you?
Strong.
What are you giving it?
Very strong. I'm not sure where we rank. I didn't go over our last ones or our other ones to see where it goes.
I did.
Did you?
Because I wanted to make sure I didn't mess it up.
off the cuff, I got to go 95. I'm taking 5% off just because of the stupid coach thing. And that's pretty much it. The stupid coach thing really bothered me. But only 5% worth, so 95. It's good, solid score.
All right,
I'm going 95 as well. Same exact thing. It's my favorite movie. I think it was funnier than I wanted it to be. It had this just enough seriousness to it. I thought it was well acted, and it was like we said, it's a lot. It's a high school cliche, somewhat movie, but it really didn't come off like a cliche movie. I thought it was really well done. Also, think it's lightning in a bottle. Like I don't. This director, writer, nothing against her, Greta Gerwig or whatever. I doubt she can ever make another movie at this level. It seems like this is so personal and it's such a like story that she knew all the nuances to. I'd be interested to see what she makes next, but I think this is lightning in a bottle where she made semi-automatic.
She had this story in her for years and like finally got to make it.
Like this was her masterpiece that she's put 15 years into. Like a lot of times how bands' first albums are so good and then they have to figure out what the next one's going to be. And like, well, that was my whole life.
Yeah.
But 95.
I'm up there with you guys. I wrote it down beforehand. I'm giving it a 93. Really loved the movie. I think it was great. I think that's the highest
94
rating I've given.
Yeah, 94.3. I think Mudbound got a 93, which was... Our next highest after this.
Okay, yeah, cool. I think this is definitely better than Mudbound.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mudbound's a little heavier.
Which I loved as well.
Yeah. The only thing we've ranked higher than that is Stranger Things Season 2. It was 98, I believe.
Yes.
Yeah, we really like that.
We really loved it, yeah.
all right.
I think we all know what the popcorns are going to be.
Yeah, it's 5.
I don't know.
5.
Oh, I had a 4.
4?
Nope, that's 5.
I was... I was, like, kind of giddy watching it because I just enjoyed it so much.
I had such a good time watching this movie. It was, like, sad and sweet and heartfelt. And I just, like, it ended on a somber note, but I walked out of the theater with a big grin on my face being like, I enjoyed that, and I enjoy life.
I loved Saoirse's character so much. Like, every time she was talking, she never said anything boring.
And
every line was something witty and gave myself like I smirked, I chuckled, and I was like I went and watched it by myself, and I wish someone else was there so I can like just kind of give a little elbow like, how about that guy, you know?
Yep. Yeah. And the pacing was good.
I agree.
Yep.
But it was also none of her lines felt like they were too witty for a teenager.
Nope. It was spot on.
Something that me or like my friends would say back in the day.
Yep. It goes back to nostalgia. Like this is everyone I wanted to be when I was that age.
Yep.
Yeah. 100%. So, if we were going to see the movie again, what would we drink with it? I'm going to start this off. I would drink a Manhattan while watching this movie.
Oh, because she went to New York? Is that what it is?
Got it?
Nice.
Yeah?
Yep.
All right, Sheehan, what are you drinking?
I'm drinking a Shirley Temple.
Why?
But I'm chasing it with some Christ crackers.
Wow. Nice. That's creepy. All
right.
That's what they were snacking on.
I'm drinking Soco Amaretto Lime.
Okay. Oh, so I think why?
You don't know the reference?
No.
None of you guys are brand new fans or were back in the day?
Oh, yes.
I'm gonna stay 18 forever.
Yep. Jesus Christ.
That brought me back a little bit.
Yeah, that album, Deja Antinu, that never left my car in high school. Repeat the whole time.
And we'll never miss a party. Because we keep them going constantly. Such teenage bullshit.
It really is bad.
But it's so good.
So good.
Like, yep. It's bad, but it's good.
Really
good.
Stay 18 forever. All
right. That wraps up our review of Lady Bird. Let's, we're not doing, are we? Checking time. We are not going to be doing our weekly recommendations, but we got a special treat for y'all. We're going to break down each of our top five movies of 2017. How do you guys want to do this? Should we start at number five and like work our way up?
I think we got to do like you give your list. Gene gives it, however, one list at a time.
All right. One list. Everybody knows the rules. Gene. What's your list?
All right. I'm going to go five first, okay?
All right. I like that. We got to build up to our favorite movies of the year.
All right. So maybe a bit of a surprise, because considering how much I hated the original, Blade Runner 2049. Woo! Such a strong movie. That's one that marinates with you. It's like a fine wine. Woo! The more you sit with it, the more I sit here and talk with you guys about movies, the more I'm thinking that one was just fantastic.
I can't wait to watch it again.
Yep. All right. Four. Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri.
Huh?
With my ending.
Three Billboards?
Okay. All right. Number three is easy. It's I, Tonya. You guys haven't seen that yet?
I haven't seen it yet, so it's hard.
Yeah, I know. It is. I love what they did with the with how they shot and told the story with the conflicting interviews. Mm-hmm. You'll understand what I mean. I just love that story in general. I can't get enough of that whole Olympic ordeal. Every documentary is just as fascinating as the next. Perfect. Number two, Logan. Superhero movie, yes. Up for an award, should be up for more awards.
Yeah, it definitely got snubbed.
This is the death of the first death of a superhero we've ever seen in major cinema. And it's one of the biggest superheroes out there, Jimmy, right?
Well, two, really.
Two, yeah. Superman. Yeah.
Well, no, I meant two in this movie.
Superman's not dead yet.
Oh, okay.
Well, he was, kind of, but he came back. Spoiler alert.
See, he's back, so he's not dead. Number one, spoiler, Lady Bird.
Nice.
All right.
Yep. But nice. I have an honorable mention.
Okay. I have a couple honorable. If we're doing honorable mentions, I have a couple.
You get one honorable mention.
Yeah, I'm doing honorable mention because for this podcast alone, Logan Lucky, it was our first podcast together.
Go back, listen to it. Horrible audio quality. Subscribe, rate 5 stars.
I was hungover as shit. I didn't prepare recommendations. I didn't prepare anything. I just kind of stumbled onto the computer and started chit-chatting at 12 in the morning on a Sunday. Thank God we just stopped doing it in the mornings. But yeah, I'm always going to think of Logan Lucky and think, oh yeah, that's what kicked off Six Pack Cinema.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yes. Nice. That's a solid little solid memory there. Jimmy, awesome. You want to go next or you want me to?
You go.
Okay. I will start with my number five, Baby Driver. I don't think it was the most well-made movie of the year, but I recently rewatched it, and it reminded me how much fun I had watching it in theaters last year, and it completely caught me by surprise. I saw the trailer 2 days before I saw the movie, and I was like, all right, I'll go see that, not realizing the whole movie was going to be synced to his soundtrack. And it was a great time. And sometimes that's all you need from a movie.
That's really all you need.
Yeah. All right, my number four is It. Love the movie. Love the book. That's my all-time favorite book. Felt like this was a better adaptation than the 1991 TV series, miniseries.
Sure.
Just loved it. Pennywise scared the shit out of me growing up. Read that book way too young and couldn't sleep through a night for at least a month. So I'm excited for part two to come out next year, I think. Number three, Wind River, which was the thematic sequel to Hell or High Water, which is in my top three movies of all time.
Mm-hmm.
And I just anything from that writer. He wrote Sicario as well. So
I didn't know that was a sequel.
It's not like actually people are saying like Sicario, Hell or High Water,
same universe.
Wind River are like it's thematically like very similar.
Really?
But they're
okay.
They're
it's not a sequel.
Any overlapped and yeah.
Okay.
Not,
it's like no saying
story overlapped.
It's like saying Quentin Tarantino's movies are all in the same universe. That's
okay. I could buy that, sure.
Yeah. So yeah, love that. Number two, Lady Bird, as we just discussed. I really love that one. And then number one, Blade Runner 2049. Like I loved it when we first saw it, and since then my love for it has only grown. It's just a perfect movie. Somebody got me a very nice bottle of the Blade Runner official whiskey that I am looking to crack open probably Oscar night. Enjoy that while I'm watching the Oscars. And watch cool Blade bottle. Runner win way too many Oscars. Well, not enough Oscars, really.
It's going to win zero, but I
think it'll luck. Get... Wait, and one more thing. I realized this either this week or last week. Remember during our Blade Runner episode when I said a lot of the effects were practical and you guys were shitting on me? Mm-hmm. Just so you know, every city shot besides for the holograms was shot with miniatures.
You broke up.
That qualifies as special effects.
But no, yeah, but they're not. I was saying it wasn't CG, and you guys were saying no, it's all CG.
No.
Play the tape.
Look.
Put
back.
The tape
said,
in.
There
Jimmy,
was,
put
there
the
was
tape
almost
in
no
here.
Special effects. You're garbage people. Blah, blah, blah. No, that,
well,
that's
no,
a,
you
that's a
are garbage
effect,
people.
Sir.
That, yeah, it's that was, obviously special effects. They didn't build actual hologram machines.
Fucking
but
holograms
saying,
running
that's
around.
That's what we were trying to.
Lasers.
That's what we were trying to tell you.
No, yeah, you're an
and
idiot.
And floating cars and motorcycles and robots. Totally real.
Yes, no, you guys were saying it was all CGI, and I was saying, no, they did a lot of it practically.
Okay.
Which is miniatures and that type of stuff.
Okay, I think
fucking sucks.
If that's the case, then you misunderstood what we were trying to tell you.
No, you guys are idiots and are backpedaling on your argument now.
You're
garbage
a garbage
people.
Person.
I mean, I would still say that
get your kid
miniatures
like
are special effects.
All right. Jimmy, what's your... Oh, and my honorable mention goes to Logan. I think that should have been nominated for more awards.
Okay. All right. My number five is Dunkirk. And...
Excellent choice.
I didn't, like, walk away from the theater loving it, thinking it would be my top five. But the more I think about that movie, the more I think it's the most uniquely made movie I've seen recently that really works. And it's bizarre. Because no characters, no plot, no dialogue.
But it has a plot. For sure it's a plot.
Okay, no characters, no dialogue.
Yeah. I understand what you mean. It's
and you're fully you're fully immersed and feel what they're feeling. It kind
of
sucks.
You
sucked.
Can't figure it out until like about a third of the way through. You start piecing together. I like when you have to piece things together as you go.
Yeah, I like that. Okay, number four, Disaster Artist. I thought that was a really good mix of humor and... Wild, it's a wild real life story, and they kind of made him humanized, whatever. Disaster Artist. Number three, Mudbound.
Mm-hmm.
Rewatchability not up there, but I thought like that is also in the feels. So I got a lot of heavy hitters.
Yeah, you do.
Number two, Wind River. We should have probably reviewed this movie if me and Dave liked it this much. There's one scene in Wind River
apparently.
That is so good.
I think that came out right before we started to do the podcast.
The scene,
just
Dave,
that window.
The scene where they're walking to the trailer and he goes, why are you flanking me? You see that? You see that? You're flanking me is so good.
I just got goosebumps for that scene.
I rewatched that scene like twice now. Just that scene because it's so
the
well
whole,
made.
I think the whole John Barenthal scene as well.
Who? Which one?
John Barenthal. The guy who's the Punisher.
Still not there. Oh, yes, the flashback.
Trying to, like, not give things away.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, it's a flashback, and it's brutal. It's also really heavy. And then one, yes. Lady Bird.
Lady Bird.
Honorable mention, I Don't Feel at Home in This World Anymore on Netflix. That was a nice, fun crime thingy.
I've never heard of that.
With Elijah Wood? No, not Elijah Wood. Yeah, Elijah Wood. And the New Zealand chick.
Sweet.
Yeah.
All right. Awesome.
Those are top five movies we recorded in February. Cool.
Yeah. Perfect timing.
Makes sense.
Well, that wraps up this week's episode of Six Pack Cinema. Tune in next week, and we will be reviewing The Darkest Hour. See you guys next week. Bye. You've got your ball, you've got your chain tied to me tight, tight, we are bugging.